So I'm so excited. Like, you have no idea. Whenever you told me that you would do this, like, I had so many nerves. I was shaking. I was crying. Like, I just absolutely adore you.
Oh, thank you.
Whenever, you know, I've seen you, I've been in now for 4.5 years. So whenever I, can y'all see me? Like, it just shows my name.
No.
What's going on? Just see my name. Oh my gosh, this is so ridiculous. Okay, hold on. Is that me? No. Oh, there I am. Okay. But so I've been in for 4.5 years, and whenever I, you know, I've seen you on stage, I've heard you, you've always been, and you are, so blue to me, right? You're just so excited and fun and just totally opposite from me. And so I was so excited whenever I found a Zoom that you first did with Rachel Williamson. And it literally, like, brought me to tears. Just some of the things that you said were just exactly what I had gone through, some of the same feelings I had had. And it just, in that Zoom, I was just like, oh my gosh, I am in love with her. You know, even though I've known you or kind of knew you for like 4.5 years. And then I found the one with Sherry Lynn, and that one was incredible. Like, and I have just been like so just amazed by you since then, because in those Zooms, you brought out a yellow personality that I had not seen before.
Oh, and very yellow.
Yeah, and I love it. So I just want to thank you, first of all, for being on here with us, because it is just, for you to take the time out to do this with our team is just incredible. Very humbled by it. And like I told you, I don't want to do any kind of question or answer thing. I know that you always pray. You ask God to, you know, whatever's on, you know, whatever he wants you to say, you're going to say. And I think that whatever you have to share is what our team needs to hear. So I'm just going to turn it over to you, if that's okay.
Absolutely.
And kind of let you just share whatever's on your heart.
All right, Crystal. Thank you so much. I do want to say thank you for having me on here. I take it as an honor, and I don't take these kinds of things lightly. You know, like you said, I do pray over what I'm to say, and I just, you know, give God my mouth and my thoughts, and I just tell him to just, you know, speak through me whatever needs to be said. And you know, you're right, I am so blue that I'm not a prepared person. I'm not detailed. I'm a fly by the seat of my pants kind of girl, and I'm all over the place. I mean, I can get easily distracted. You know, that movie, was it Up, where the little dog goes, squirrel, where? You know, I mean, that's me. So I can tend to rattle on and just kind of go here and there, and I'll usually get myself back on track, because it's almost like something just popped into my head. And if I don't say it right then, I'm going to forget it. And
yeah, that's awesome.
It's something that I needed to say.
Yeah, that's perfect.
So I just want to put that little disclaimer or whatever on there, that I'm going to be all over the place, but I hope you can follow me. So,
absolutely.
You know, and it's so true. I am very yellow as well. You know, and not in the way that a lot of people think what a yellow is. You know, I mean, you know what? Hey, yellows, we need to unite. I mean, we're just as powerful as a red. We just do things nicer. You know what I mean? we're just a little bit more, we think about things a little bit before we speak, you know, whereas a red a lot of times doesn't have a filter. And, you know, but we're a little more slow going, you know, not as ambitious maybe as a red personality, definitely not detailed at all. My blue, yellow, it's just, there's just no, I'm either too scattered to be, you know, organized, or I'm too, it's too much trouble to be more organized, you know? So, anyhow, I really do hope that I give you hope, that if somebody like me can take this all the way to the top without social media, and just basically purely on getting out, meeting people and finding some other people. You know, I always looked at myself and thought, you know, I may not be the brightest person on you know, there and but I can find some people who are. You know, I might not be the most eloquent of speech, but I can find somebody who is. I might not be the most witty person, but I can find somebody who is. And, you know, if I had known way back then in June of 2005 that I would be where I am today, I would have been scared to death. I would have self-sabotaged. I would have stopped myself somehow, some way. I would have been so scared. But the good news is that when you build this business, and if you're building it right and you're building it through relationships, you are going to grow into what you're going to become. And God, you know, he does not qualify the called. He doesn't call the qualified. He qualifies the called. And so that's what he did with me. You know, just a little bit about my background. Blair and I had been in network marketing. In fact, tomorrow is 27 years since we signed up into our very first network marketing business. So it was January the 26th, 1990, when we got into our first networking business. And we signed up with some friends of ours because, well, I mean, we didn't know what network marketing was. We didn't know what dreaming was and that whole idea of setting goals and things like that. You know, we just knew that we worked hard and we had four kids we were trying to raise. We just knew that we wanted a little more out of life. But we didn't ever know how we were going to get it because we were working as hard as we could doing what we were doing. Blair was in construction. He was a framer and he owned his own business. So it was a feast or famine kind of thing. In the summertime, we always had good money, but you know, in the winter, it was very, very, you know, it was very hard. It was famine. I mean, you know, so we had to put up just kind of like the chipmunks and the bears and stuff do. They work hard and put the stuff up in the summer and the fall, and then that way they've got stuff for the winter. And so we had to learn how to do that. I was a secretary. Oh my gosh, that's about the funniest thing ever for somebody who is not organized. I was actually an administrative assistant to a vice president of a big insurance company. And that just blew my mind because I walked in off the street with no resume and just applied for a job and ended up, I worked for 2 weeks as a receptionist where I started in the little satellite office to going up to the big building and working for one of the main guys and had to, I mean, with no resume. And my first job was to send out letters to all these qualified resumed people that he interviewed. And I'm looking at these resumes and thinking, oh my gosh, college educated. Oh, wow. They are more than qualified to do this job. Why did I get this job? You know, and so that actually, when I look back, that's what started me on the road to know that if God has a plan, it's going to happen whether you believe it or not, you know. And that job is what I was doing when we got introduced to network marketing. And, you know, we got into a company. Fell in love with the idea of network marketing because it really truly is a way that you, the common, or me, the common average everyday person that seizes the opportunity and runs for it can actually, you know, make a lot of money and can become a millionaire if they choose to, you know. I don't know of any other profession that you can do that at. I mean, we make more than doctors do, you know? And I certainly didn't want to spend how many ever years of education that they have to spend, 12, 20, I don't know, and then still have to pay off all that debt and everything. You know, we can do that through network marketing. And so we realized that. But for 15 years, we were either in the wrong business at the wrong time, wrong marketing plan, wrong products, whatever. Always seemed to be a little, you know, a day late and a dollar short. Not, you know, maybe that company had already had its run. It was old, you know, it was an old company. Two of them were really old companies that we were with, you know, more than 30 years old. So it was something that we grew a lot because we were 34 years old when we got into our very first network marketing business, 34. And we had to change. We had to grow. We had to read books. I mean, we got introduced to some amazing books. We listened to cassette tapes. Our car was a rolling university. You know, we didn't listen to music. We listened to other successful people talking about what it took, talking about the failures that they had, talking about, you know, having to change, having to grow. And so we had that year, you know, those years, 15 years of that when I got introduced to It Works. But what was different about It Works than any other thing that we'd ever done was we had a product that nobody else had. We had a product that I got extremely excited about. You know, the other things that we'd ever done, seriously, not by their corporate company, but by the leadership, you know, the distributorships, they would on stage say, don't worry about what the product is. Just buy it, buy your required amount and give it away, throw it away, you know, whatever you want to do with it, bury it in the backyard. Don't even talk about it. Just sign up, teach others how to sign up and buy those products, whether you like them or not, and keep building your network that way. And that was every single business we were in pretty much had that philosophy. It was not product driven. It was not customer driven. And every single one of those would have a clause in their policies and procedures that said, you must have at least 10 customers. And I would say, well, this says we got to have 10 customers. They're like, no, don't worry about it. That's just, don't worry about it. You know, so we built based on the opportunity, not on actually being passionate and falling in love with our products. So, you know, in network marketing, I would say 15 years in that profession is a long time to really see a lot that's going on out there. And it really hasn't changed that much today as far as, you know, some of the products. You know, network marketing is notorious for having very, very expensive products. Most of the time, whenever you leave a network marketing company, you wouldn't even think about becoming a customer with them because their products, that wasn't the focus and you weren't passionate about it. So here we have people that will, for whatever reason, they may not want to build the business anymore, but a lot of times they'll convert themselves to a customer because they've fallen in love with our products. We have good products at a good price, very affordably priced, and they work. And the wrap, I think a lot of people today that have built on social media, they really don't understand the magic of the wrap. They have not seen it put on people time after time after time after time and getting result after result after result after result. And so, you know, people that have built on social media, they're excited about their opportunity. They love the greens. They love the other products, but I don't think they really understand the magic behind the wrap. You know, when we were wrapping people, we were measuring. And I would tell you, measure people. We can't talk about inch loss, okay? We cannot go posting inch loss, but we can measure people. The company never told us we could not measure people. They just said we can't talk about inch loss. So if you want people to get excited, start measuring or let them have the measuring tape. Just hand it to them and say, hey, just take a couple of measurements on your stomach before we put this wrap on you because I want to make sure you realize that you just got a good result, you know. And so that was very key in the excitement that people had when I was building the business back then. And it was exciting. Every time, I mean, when I first started, I knew it worked for me. It worked for Blair. It worked for my friends. And when I became a distributor and I started wrapping people, you know, I was building my confidence in the product. You know, I knew it worked for me. But I, you know, I was still kind of like, but is it going to work for the majority of the people? And in order for me to build my confidence in that product, I had to keep putting that product on people. And I would be, you know, I would put it on somebody and on the outside, I'm all calm, cool, and collected and saying, I'm so confident you're going to get a result. You're going to love this. And on the inside, I'm going, oh, Lord, please, please, please let them get a result. Please, Lord, let them lose, you know. And then when we went back to remeasure them, they got a result. And I'd be like, see, I told you, isn't this great? And on the inside, I was going, thank you, God. Oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God. You know, and so, and after a while, when it worked again and again and again and again, it was really odd when it didn't work for somebody, you know. And so we had to learn, why was it not working for somebody? What happened there? And we learned all that along the way. We learned that it was important that they drink water. We learned that it was important that they didn't have any kind of lotions or oils on their body. We learned that using Dove soap could cause you not to get a good result because it's very clogging to the skin. So we learned all these things along the way. And when you can explain that to people, then they're not disappointed when they don't get a result the first time. And so it's so important that you, you know, tell them what to expect. One, they're going to lose. Two, nothing's going to happen. Or three, they're going to bloat. And explain why and be positive about all of it. I mean, people that bloat usually have a better result than the ones that don't. But if they don't know that, then they're really disappointed. They went there to lose and instead they gained. And if you don't explain that to them beforehand, you know, don't wait until after they've gained it and then try to back up and go, wait a minute. I mean, that's something that could have happened. You know, no, tell them beforehand. And you present that in that way that I believe, you know, 9 out of 10 of you are going to get a result with the very first wrap. But some of you, it might take the next day before you see your result or the next day. It's a full 72 hours for the treatment to fully metabolize and everything. It might take the second wrap, it could take the third or even the fourth, but usually by that time, everybody's had a result. Or if you bloat, it's just because it's really working good on you. You're just getting rid of a lot of stuff out of there and drink your water. That's going to go down and then you're going to see your result. And the ones that bloat have a better result. So if you understand me right, you're going to hope you bloat. And then people will be, woo, yeah, I hope I bloat, you know? So, you know, those are the things that I learned along the way. And I just knew if I could get that rap on people, they were either going to become a customer or they were going to become a distributor or they were going to do nothing. And I thought 2 out of 3 ain't bad. And if they did nothing, if I followed up with them, they would usually do something. And that's how I built my business all the way to ambassador. You know, it took me 4.5 years to get to ambassador. Belly to belly. And like I said, it wasn't all me, because had it been all me, I mean, it just wasn't going to happen. Because thank God for network marketing, it's not just everything that you do. It is based on the efforts of others as well. And everybody doing their own thing, building their own business. You know, I think with social media, Crystal, can I just get really real with y'all?
Please do.
Okay. So with social media, what happened with that is because it was so new and there were so many people getting in. I mean, I never had that experience. I don't know. I guess it was my age or whatever. I just didn't jump on that bandwagon in the early days. And I was still out traveling and doing and working my business the old fashioned way. And I wasn't paying much attention to social media. People would sponsor, you know, 30, 40 people in a month and put in, you know, 20, 30, 40 people as customers a month. And I mean, we never had that kind of success like that. I mean, on a good month, I might put in 5 people on a good month. Customers just, you know, maybe 10 on a good month. And so what happened with so many people, you had to do something with them. And early on, distributors discovered that they could just basically put the people in the charts and just start methodically building the charts. Well, it seemed good. But what happened was, is that they were not building relationships with people. And it became about how much you as the distributor could do, not who's going to partner with me and build their own business. It became a mindset that said, if I have to fill in every stinking box for me to go diamond, I'm doing it. And if I have to give away all my customers to build volume in those boxes, I'm doing it. And people did that. And they made a lot of money doing that with their cab bonuses. But those same people, not all of them, but some, are struggling today because they don't have that social media explosion that they used to have. It's like pulling teeth to get somebody to sign up through social media these days. And so, not that it can't be done, and not that you should not continue to use it, because it is it's a very powerful tool, but use it to build relationships with people. You know, don't spam people. Don't cold message people. Just, you know, you meet them today and you tell them their kids are cute, and then have you tried that crazy rap thing? I mean, that might have worked at one time, but not anymore. In fact, people don't like us because of that. And you don't want to get that reputation, you know, that all you care about is yourself, because that's how it comes off. You don't care about that person at all, you know. And so that's what, there's where the shift came, was that it went from network marketing to something else entirely, but it wasn't network marketing. And network marketing is about finding people who want to work a business. And you lock arms with them, you build a relationship with them, and you go to work. You know, you don't just give everything away. It doesn't work that way. Somebody has to have skin in the game, or else they're not going to build their business. And then you turn around, and those same people that have put all these people in, they've enrolled them all, and they've thrown customers all in there and everything. They've built the volume. They made their good bonuses, but then nobody's working. And then they wonder, why isn't anybody working? And as soon as they take a break, everything starts to crumble. And that's because that's not how you build network marketing. Network marketing is about you working with others that are building their own business, like I said. So it caused explosive growth in our company. Explosive growth. People going ambassador in less than a year, you know, which was just, I mean, it took me, well, let me back up. When I got involved, it was June of 2005. The company was 4 years old. They had just turned four in March. I got in June 2005. By January 2007, 20 years ago, was that 20 years ago? No, 10 years ago. The company only had a handful of diamonds and double diamonds. That was it. Nobody had gone triple diamond yet in our company. And our company was getting ready to be 6 years old. And Pam was in the field working. You know, all we had was Pam, Dr. Don, Mark, Cindy. That was it. We didn't have what we have today. And Pam was the one, she was the representative. You know, we're all under Pam. Y'all realize that, right? We're all under Pam. Because she started this crazy thing. And so, you know, we're one of Pam's legs. Cammie's one of Pam's legs. Jody and Stan Gravely are one. And then Kay's one. And then who's the other one? A bunch of people that are over in France. That's another leg. So in what I'm trying to say is in 6 years, nobody had gone triple diamond. Okay. So Mark called us all together, diamonds and above, to come to Greensboro, North Carolina for a diamond and above meeting. We met in a restaurant. It was a steakhouse. And there were seven of us there. Five double diamonds and two diamonds. I was a double diamond at the time. And Mark issued a challenge that the first person to go triple was going to get an all-expense-paid trip to Cancun or Jamaica. And I punched Blair and I was like, that's my trip. I'm doing it. I'm going to be triple diamond. And that's when Mark introduced the cab bonuses or the diamond bonuses, you know, the 80, 80, 80s. But back then it was $50 up to 100. Today it's $80 up to 150. So I was so excited. I just knew this was what we needed. This was really going to energize things. And we were just really going to just blow it out of the water. And I came home and I was so, I mean, I had teams everywhere. And back then, you know, today we have Zooms. Today we have Skype. But back then, if I wanted to go and work with somebody, I physically went. I was on the road. If I got a new distributor signed up, I was driving or flying if they were somebody that seemed like they were really serious about building their business. So it was, I mean, a lot of travel, a lot of time I was gone. And I was able to do that. My kids were all grown. It was just Blair and I at home, and he was totally supportive. So, you know, we would travel. So I knew I was going to go on the road and just build the heck out of my business. I was going triple diamond. And I had a double, and I needed two more people to go diamond, and they were, one was an emerald and one was a ruby. So they were on their way to working towards diamond. So I just knew I was going to get out there and we were going to make this happen. Well, after we got home, it had been about a week, and my sister got devastating news that she had been diagnosed with lung cancer, and it was stage four. There really wasn't anything they could do for her, is what the doctor said. He said that she might not live 6 months. That would be the longest, you know, that would be the most that she would live, would be 6 months. And she was 8 years younger than me. She was 42 years old or 43. And so I was devastated. And I told Blair, now my sister didn't want to know. This was kind of crazy. You know, I think she knew, but she just didn't want us to speak it out. She didn't want us to say what the doctor had told her. She made my mom and I go in to get the prognosis, to get the diagnosis. She didn't even want to go in. And she sat in the waiting room. And then when we came out here, we're just devastated when he said she may not make it 6 months. And she looked at us and just, you know, saying, everything's going to be all right, right? You know, and I said, do you want me to tell you the truth or what? And she said, don't tell me anything negative. And so that was a challenge, because I couldn't talk to her about the reality of what was happening to her. And there was no way that she would allow us to talk about it. So I told Blair, I said, you know what? I'm going to put my business on the back burner and I'm going to go, I'm just going to spend time with my sister. And Blair was fine with that. He said, you do what you need to do. Well, I went to my sister. Now, she was my biggest cheerleader. I mean, she was a loyal customer, but she was doing very well in her job. She had a very good job and doing better than, you know, a lot of people do. She was an executive with Dell Computers. And so she was very happy doing what she was doing, but she was a green personality. She was very, very organized, and she knew I was so disorganized. And so she was telling me that whenever she got better, you know, when this all passed, that she was going to come work for me and she was going to straighten me out and make me, you know, she was going to get me organized and get me doing the right things and all, because I was so scattered. But so anyhow, I came home and I went to her and I told her that I had made a decision that I wanted to spend time with her. And I'll never forget, she looked at me and she said, oh, no, you're not. She goes, don't you realize by now? She goes, this isn't about me and you. This is so much bigger than us. She said, don't you realize this is what God put you on this earth to do? This is what you were born to do. And for you to sit here with me is not in the plan. And she was just, you know, she said, you're going to go out there. You're going to build your business. You have people that are looking up to you. You have people that are on your team that, you know, you have a purpose. You have a plan, and God has a plan for you, and you are not going to sit here with me. And so she pushed me out, and every spare moment I had, I would go spend with her. But, and that was middle of January. By March 31st, I was Triple Diamond. I was the company's first Triple Diamond. And a week later, my sister passed away. So she didn't even make it 3 months, you know. So it was, and the day she passed away on Monday. And then we buried her on Wednesday. And on Thursday, I had an expo, a women's expo that I needed to be at. And I had some new girls that were going to be working in the booth. And, you know, I just kept hearing her say, this isn't about you. It's not about me. This is so much bigger than us. You have a responsibility. You've been called to do this. And I knew I had to be at that show. And I did. I worked that show. And, you know, at that time, I knew that this was big, Crystal. I just knew this was big, but it didn't fully hit me until she just straightened my face, told me that. And so I started building my business with a different attitude, with a different perspective. I didn't do it anymore for me. I started working my business for the people. I started working because I knew that if I could help someone else be successful, then they would turn around and help someone else be successful. And it could be that ripple effect that would just go on forever and ever and ever, you know, and that mattered to me. And, you know, so I became a Triple Diamond. By October of that same year, that was March 2007, by October of 2007, I'm making the run for presidential. Nobody had gone presidential yet, and I had everything lined up, and then my father passed away. Now, he had been sick. He was older. That's more the natural order of things, but, you know, I was a daddy's girl, so it was still devastating to lose him, but he died on Wednesday, and I was supposed to be, Blair and I had airline tickets for Friday to go to Tampa, where we were having our very first real major conference in Tampa. And this is before the company ever moved there. We were in Grand Rapids. They were, you know, the company was in Grand Rapids, but we were having our first conference in Tampa, Florida. And I was supposed to speak on that Friday night. And my mom, she was all on board. You know, my dad was from Missouri. We live in Tennessee. And my dad, you know, had his resting place was in Missouri, where his mother and father were buried. And so we had my dad transported. He died on Wednesday. We had him transported on Wednesday to Missouri. And then we drove early on Thursday morning and had a graveside service, and then got in the car, 5-hour drive, and drove back home. And Blair and I were on a plane the next day to go to Tampa, because again, it wasn't about me. This was, I, and people wouldn't blame me. You know, people, they wouldn't blame me if I didn't go to that conference. You know, I just lost my dad. But again, I was building my business with purpose. And I knew that I needed to be there. And somehow through the grace of God, I was able to speak and keep my composure, and everything was good. And y'all, that conference, there was maybe 150 people there. Just tiny. This is October of 2007. But I did go presidential that month. And then it was another 2 years before I went ambassador. And for 2 years, I sat at presidential. once I hit a rank, I never lost it because I was building with the right way. I was building it the way network marketing is intended to build. So I never, ever lost rank. And October of 2009, now it was 2 years. I went presidential in October 2007. So fast forward 2009, I'm making the run for ambassador. I already have my presidential. I had my two triples. I had my two doubles. But one of my doubles, month after month, she had qualified double, month after month after month after month after month. And on this particular month, she was lacking some volume. And so everybody else had qualified. I mean, this was the, you know, the end of October. And I just, you know, ambassador was right there. Just, it was right there. Well, on the 25th of October, I'm supposed to be going on November the 1st. I was doing a big hair show in Puerto Rico, because we're in Puerto Rico. So Blair and I were going to go. We were going to leave on the 30th and spend an extra day on the 31st. And then the show started on the 1st. Well, on the 25th, I get a call from my mom, and my nephew died suddenly of pneumonia. My brother's only child, and he was 33 years old, and he died unexpectedly of pneumonia. And on the same day, about 2 hours later, my mom called again, and she just said, I cannot believe this has happened, but your uncle, my dad's brother, my favorite uncle in the whole wide world, died of a massive heart attack on the same day. And this is 5 days before we're supposed to leave. And my uncle lived in Missouri. And so what ended up happening was we buried my nephew on Wednesday, drove to Missouri on Thursday and had his service, drove back home, and Blair and I were on a plane to go to Puerto Rico on Friday. But at this point, I was like a zombie. I mean, I was just like, it doesn't matter to me if I go ambassador or not. I just didn't even want to look at it, you know. And as it all turned out, what I didn't know, I left my phone at home. I was, you know, just so distraught and so out of it that I wasn't even thinking. And I had left my cell phone at home. And so the girl that was staying with my dogs was supposed to bring, she was going to overnight my phone. Well, I had looked at the volume of this last double diamond, and she was still about $5,000 away from maintaining her double diamond. And that was all I lacked, being ambassador. And so I just thought, well, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't matter to me. I'm just devastated, you know. Well, sure enough, I left my phone, and I didn't know, but this gal had called and left a message, and she said, I cannot believe that I am $5,000 away from maintaining my double diamond. I don't know how I'm going to get it done, but I'm going to get it done. I will be double diamond before this night is over with. And she didn't even know I was going ambassador. I never told her. She just was like, she was a very red personality. And she's like, this is the first time I've ever lost my rank, and I'm not losing it, you know? And so, and she did it. She did it. And then I became ambassador on October the 31st of 2009. And I stayed there for 2 years. And then Cammy, she went ambassador in March of 2010. So she was right behind me. So for 2 years, her and I were the only ambassadors in the company. And then social media came on, and it just started going crazy from there. But I just said all that to say that somewhere along the line, you guys, this isn't just about wraps. This isn't just about a company that sells products, that we market products. This is about people's lives. And God has chosen many other things too, but he's definitely chosen It Works as a vehicle for changing people's lives. And because of the nature of our products, that they are affordable, that they are unique, that the wraps there's nothing else out there like it. It puts us all on a level playing field. You know, in the other network marketing businesses that my husband and I did, we realized that you had to be sharp as all get out. You had to be smart. You had to be with it. You had to dress the part. You had to act the part. I mean, you couldn't just be who you were and, you know, just somebody that didn't have any people skills or whatever and ever hope to make it in some of these other businesses, because you just had to be on your A game. Well, and it works. You don't have to be on your A game. You can be just who you are right out the gate, start making money, and go all the way to the top of this pay plan without people skills, without, you know, being the sharpest crayon in the box. You know, you, because of that rap, because of the products, because as long as you're putting that product on, people are talking about it, you're going to find the people that are going to continue to help build your business. And they're going to be building their own business, but in turn, it helps you build yours. So, I mean, that's all I ever did, was I just knew I could find some other people. And when you break it down to the lowest denominator, you're looking for five quality people, right? Five quality people in one in each leg, five different legs. Doesn't matter where they are. And you can go ambassador. So you, that's what you have to look at, that you are five quality people away from ambassador. So you just got to keep putting it out there, keep putting it out there, keep putting it out there. And I know it's frustrating. I know right now, especially 2016 was a very different kind of a year. Very different. And a lot of people have left the company. But you got to hear me on this, y'all. People didn't leave because they were making money. And when you hear a top earner, former top earner, that says, I left a five-figure a month income, or I left a six-figure a month income, and you better be paying attention, because if I did that, you got to know that I had a good reason for it. Well, yeah, it's because they weren't making that money. Seriously, they weren't making that money. They had lost their income. And instead of working to get it back and do it the right way, they decided to go somewhere else. And to me, you know, some of these people I loved, some of these people I really admired and I thought a lot of. But if they are not supposed to be here, then I have to say, so long. You know, we've got business to do here, and you cannot look at some of these other people that have left and think that there is something wrong with our company. That is the furthest thing from the truth. And some of these people didn't just leave on their own. Some of them were terminated. So you don't know the whole story, and it's not as it appears on Facebook. So don't let people trick you into thinking that they've got something better, because I can tell you they left the best to go to something else. There's two companies right now that a lot of these leaders have gone to, three companies. And I mean, they're old as dirt. I mean, really, really old. And they're like making a resurgence, trying to, you know, get people from other companies. Some of these CEOs of a couple of these companies paid some of our top earners to come over. They paid them. They paid them to bring their team with them. And so, you know, just be careful about what you see on social media. Take it with a grain of salt. You have to know that we really, truly have something very special. We have something so special. And I don't know what Mark has got up his sleeve for, you know, at conference, what announcements he's going to make. I know that we're still going to get some more products. I don't know what they are. I don't know what it is. But, I mean, we have to have that. And Mark knows that, in order for us to continue to be a viable company in the marketplace. And there's going to be some promotions. I have no idea, but I do know that Mike had said at one point that this year was going to be different than any other year, that bonuses and promotions were going to be attainable for everyone, that they were going to be on a smaller scale, and you know, to where everybody can have a chance, where everybody feels that they have an opportunity to win and to, you know, to get some of these promotions. I think a lot of people look at some of the prior promotions and think, oh, well, there's no way I can be diamond by the end of March. Here it is, the middle of February, and they run a promotion that says you got to go diamond by March, and they just give up. They don't even try. Because they've already quit before they've even tried. So, you know, Mark, I know, wants to appeal to the masses, not just the few at the top, because this business is about people. And if you ever doubt Mark and Cindy's intentions, integrity, you know, what they have in store for us, I've never seen a CEO that treats its distributors the way that Mark and Cindy love on us, the money that they have thrown at us. I mean, you know, 2 years ago or 3 years ago, whenever it was, he gave away $20,000 to 20 people and then turned around and did it again and then did it again. 60 people got $20,000 each, and all they had to do was get one customer, one distributor. That's it. And then here, just this year, this last year, $1 million. He gave away $1 million. All you had to do was get one distributor, one loyal customer to be in that drawing. And 100 people got $10,000 each. Nobody does that. No other CEO has ever done that. You know? Constantly he's doing promotions, constantly trying to make it to where people can get excited about their business and do what, I mean, we didn't have that kind of incentive when I was building all the way to ambassador. I mean, Mark did something to get us all excited about going triple, but that was the only thing. We didn't have no good bonuses. You know, the pay plan paid good without all of that. And I hear people say today, oh, I'm not going to build my business. I'm going to hope that Mark's going to come out with some more bonuses. I'm going to wait till conference. And I'm like, are you crazy? There's so much money in this marketing plan. I mean, just go build your business and you're going to make money. Go wrap some people and you'll make money. I promise you, you will. You know, and let's see, what time is it? Okay, yeah, it's getting up about 45 minutes. We've been into this. There's one thing that I want to talk to you about, and I feel like somebody needs to hear this here. You know, if you've ever wondered if you're doing the right thing, if you, you know, maybe you're tired, maybe you're a little frustrated, you know, maybe it just hasn't gone the way you think it should, that maybe you haven't grown as fast as you could as far as ranking up or whatever, but I can tell you that God is going to give you what you need to build your business the way he wants you to build it, the way he's intended for you to build it, which is through relationships, through bringing other people on board and being very intentional about valuing them, making them feel valued. This isn't about bringing in somebody and popping two customers under there and then moving on to the next person. And that's what it had turned into, which is why we're struggling right now with our public relations. You know, I mean, we've been given a bad rap. Oh, God, I didn't mean to be, that was a pun. I don't mean that. I mean, we've been given a bad name by people who have done that have used people. And there's a lot of angry ex-distributors out there. So, You gotta know that some of these people are gonna come back because they loved It Works. They just weren't treated properly by their sponsor or by their upline. They were treated like a number and they weren't valued. and they were really hurt. And I've heard a lot of people in the field that is what happened to them. But guess what? They're coming back. Some are coming back, and they're going to come in under you that are building your business with integrity, that are going to treat them with value and respect them. You know, they're going to be looking for people like you to take an interest in who they are, not just somebody who's a body in a box that as soon as you put two customers under there, they make their cab bonus and their fast start and they're on to the next one. That is not what this business was intended to do. So if you're frustrated and you're questioning and you're wondering if you have the ability to do this, or do you have the skills to do it? I'm going to say yes. Yes, you have it. You just might have to dig a little deeper. You might have to read a little bit more. And I encourage you, you are like the books you read and the people you surround yourself with. There may be some relationships that you need to let go of that is holding you back from becoming a better person or becoming a more people-skilled person. Because let's face it, and I don't know why this happens, but a lot of times your friends want to see you do well. They just don't want you to do better than them. And they will bring you down. You know, they'll make fun of you. They will sneer at you, you know, if you're trying to do better than them. I kind of equate it to a pigsty. You know, pigs don't know that pigs stink, right? So pigs, they're in the sty. They're all together down there, just, you know, cohabitating together in that sty. But if somebody dares to come out of that sty to do better, to get out of that mud, then those pigs are going to holler back at them and pull them back down. So where do you think you're going? You're no better than us. You know, you don't need to go out there. And so that's what you're going to have. You're going to have people that are going to do that to you. And it could even be your family. You know, so you have to determine what you want from this business. You have to say that this is what I want. I want it bad enough to be able to do whatever it takes for me to do it that's legal, moral, and ethical. And that I'm going to stick in here as ever, however long it takes for me to do it, because I have a good company with good products and I'm surrounding myself with good people. And all it is that I have to get over my thought processes, over my perceptions, over my fears, whatever it is that's keeping you from being the person that people are attracted to. And I don't mean by your looks. I mean by what's going on inside of you. Because if you've got a lot of toxic junk going on inside of you and you're constantly telling yourself that, I don't know, it's just never going to happen for me. Nobody wants to be in my business. Nobody wants this. Nobody blah, blah, blah. Then guess what? You're giving off this negative vibe. And it repels. On a subconscious level, is telling people, don't come to me because I'm not good enough. You don't want to come in business with me because I don't believe in myself. So you don't want that. You want to be reading, gaining your confidence, speaking over yourself good things. And this book, What to Say When You Talk to Yourself, by Shad Helmstetter. It's a fabulous book. This book tells you the science behind what it is we think and what we speak out, how powerful that is. And so if you're speaking confidence and assurance, and you are, you know, whether you're confident and assured or not is beside the point, but you speak as if you are. Okay. And because what'll happen is then your subconscious mind will start to behave that way. And if you're constantly saying, I can't get anybody. Nobody wants to do this. I can't sign up any customers. I can't sign up distributors. Your subconscious mind is going to work and saying, okay, you're the captain. Your conscious mind is the captain. Your subconscious mind is the crew. So the captain says, Nobody wants to get into business with me. The crew goes, aye, aye, Captain. Nobody's going to get into business with you because we're going to make it such in such a way that you're going to put off a vibe. You're going to look a certain way that tells people that you are not interested, that tells people that you are not approachable. You're going to make decisions that are not going to get you anywhere. Whereas if you turn around and you say things that are positive and you say, you know what, I'm a money magnet. People love me. I'm sponsoring distributors left and right. Customers love my products. They want to get in with me. Then guess what? Your subconscious mind says, aye, aye, Captain. And you start acting and doing things on a subconscious level that opens the door to who you are that people was like, I don't know what it is about her, but I just want to be around her. And so you start to attract rather than to repel. So this book, I'm telling you, you guys need to order it. What to Say When You Talk to Yourself. And it's Chad Helmstetter. And he's got scripts in here. He's got affirmations that you can read them just like they are here in the book, or you can tweak them and make them very specific to you on things like quitting smoking, weight loss, business-wise, just in your life in general. If you're afraid of people, then this is going to help you to get out of your shell. But what I did is I took, and you know, you've got a memo on your phone. Most have those recorded memos where you can record. So what I did is I took one of the scripts out of here and I, you know, altered it a little bit. And then I read it into my voice memo. And I tell myself how awesome I am, you know, and because I struggle with the same stuff y'all do. Trust me, I do. I look at some of these other leaders and I think, oh my gosh, they're so, so smart and so together, and they just have all their ducks in a row, and I'm so scattered, and I just don't, you know, I'm not as eloquent as they are. They can think of things. These ideas that they come up with are just so amazing, and I can't think of a thing to come up with. So, you know, so I have those same kinds of voices that speak to me, but on my voice memo, what I did is I recorded myself and, where is it? There it is. My self-talk. And so, there it is. I can do anything I believe I can do. I've got it, and every day I get more of it. I have talent, skills, and ability. I set goals, and I reach them. I know what I want out of life. I go after it, and I get it. People like me, and I feel good about myself. I have a sense of pride in who I am, and I believe in myself. Nothing seems to stop me. I have a lot of determination. I turn problems into advantages. I find possibilities in things that other people never give a chance. I have a lot of energy. I am very alive. I enjoy life, and I can tell it, and so can others. I go into my business that I'm a money magnet, that people love my products. People love being around me. You know, so what you do with this is at night before you go to bed, play it to yourself. And then in the morning when you get up, play it to yourself. Start your day and end your day with your devotions and your prayers or whatever, if you do that. But then make sure you listen to that voice memo, because then the crew is going to go to work to make that happen. And the next thing you know, you're going to hear a little voice in your head that says, go in there, go into that shop, give that girl a blitz card. You know, things will start to happen. Trust me on this. It's so powerful. And the last thing that I want to leave you with is when I first got started in this, after 15 years in network marketing and us never really making any money, and we worked really hard and we put a lot of stuff on credit cards. We went into debt to build our businesses. We burned out cars. I mean, we put lots and lots of miles. We put a lot of time, a lot of effort to get nothing. We were tired. And we had given up on network marketing before I got introduced to It Works. And as soon as I got introduced to It Works, I was so excited. I mean, I just jumped in with both feet and I was so excited. But then the reality of it set in. And when I was praying to God, I said, Lord, you know, this seems so good. And you know, Lord, how I've gotten excited about other opportunities in the past, but then they end up not doing what I thought they were going to do. And I end up getting burnt and I end up getting, you know, the same thing ends up happening, that none of our people can make money and nobody can do anything. And it's just the same thing. And you know, Lord, I'm tired. I'm so tired of fighting this fight. And I just don't know. This looks so good. And if it's of you, I want it. But if it's not of you, I don't want this. And this is It Works that I'm talking about. And I said, and Lord, you know, I just need to know, should I try one more time? Should I give this a go? Should I try one more time? And I kid you not, within a couple of hours, I was flipping through a magazine. And in fact, let me get it. Hang on a second. Hang on. I was flipping through this magazine and there was a full page ad for curves for women. And it was a little girl riding on a bicycle. This little girl riding on a bicycle. Now I have framed this. And out beside it in red letters. Now I had already told the Lord I was tired and should I try one more time. And out beside it in red letters. And for me, you know, I live in the Bible Belt. I'm in Tennessee. I don't know where y'all are, but you know, red letters to me indicates Jesus speaking. You know, Jesus speaks in red letters, right? So this has red letters. I don't know if y'all can see this, but it says, think of everything you'd miss if you didn't believe in trying again. And that was my sign. And I framed it. It's in my office. I keep it up on my shelf in my office because I look at what this business has done for me and what it's done for so many people. And I look at what would I have missed? What would I have missed if I hadn't believed in trying one more time? Okay. I mean, so much. I would miss the people that I have fallen in love with. I would miss watching them become millionaires, watching them build new homes, watching them pay off their debt. You know, I would have never lived in the beautiful home that I live in now on the lake, and it's half paid for. And all, I mean, we're just sucking money in to hit this and paying for it. What would I have missed? And that's what I want to leave you with. Think of what you would miss if you hadn't believed in trying again. It's so, so powerful. And you're in this business for a reason. And you just, you know, God brought you to this business. And He will see you through it. But you have to do the work. You have to be consistently doing something with your business. So, Crystal, I hope that helped.
Thank you so much. I'm in tears. Like, I don't even know if I can talk. I'm glad that you shared that part, because that part is what always gets me of your story, because I too talk to God a lot. And I have been on this roller coaster for 4.5 years, and there's been lots and lots of ups and downs. And every time, I've just never thought about quitting. But anytime I thought, okay, I'm going to back up, you know, this is not, maybe I just need to stop for a little bit. Every time I would hear Him say, don't quit. Don't quit. Like everywhere I turn, don't quit. Don't quit. You're here for a reason. You may not be triple diamond or presidential. You may not be ambassador, but you're here for a reason. I'm going to snot everywhere. I'm sorry. But it's not, like you said, it's not about the rap. It's not about the money. It's about the people and the relationships and the people that you can touch because of this business. And that's what He's told me. And so even if you guys are not where you're meant to be right now, you're here where you're at for a reason, because He's got you. Like Melody said, He's got you in that place, and He's preparing that next step for you. And in his time, it will happen. You've got to put the work in. You can't sit back and go, okay, you know, whenever. But I love that you persevered through it all. Like when your sister passed away, you could have said, I'm done. Like I'm not doing it anymore. It's too much. But you didn't. I mean, there's some people, Melody, me too. Like if I get a cold, I'm done. You know, I'm out for the week. I'm not posting. I'm not talking. I'm not doing anything. And to watch you persevere like that is just incredible. And I just love you and I love your story. And I cannot thank you enough for doing this for us. You are just amazing.
Well, you're so welcome. It's my honor and my pleasure. And I just pray that I said something that made a difference.
Absolutely. Well, before I get too much, I want to pray for us. I like to close all of mine in prayers, if y'all don't mind. So see if I can get through this. Thank you so much, Lord, for Melody agreeing to come on here with us, Lord. I'm just so proud of her for the leader that she is, Lord. She's not just a millionaire with the company. She's not just a top earner, but she is a leader, Lord, of you. She is a light for you, Lord, and she's doing so much more than just being a leader with this business, Lord. She is truly your feet, and I'm so thankful for her, Lord. I just pray that you will be with everybody on this theme, Lord. I pray that you will have opened our hearts and our eyes to let us know that it's about so much more than just the product. It's about so much more than the next rank. It's about so much more than what our volume is even for the month, Lord. I just pray that you will just help us to remember that through it all, and just let us know that you have us here for a reason, Lord. We just thank you so much for the friendships that we built because of this business, Lord, and just pray that we give all the glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Oh, sorry, guys. All right. Thank you so much, Melody, so much. I hope you have a fabulous evening. All right. Thank you all for getting on.
All right. Thank you
so much. Good night.